Summer is here and Mother Nature has turned up the thermostat. How does heat affect growing plants and the gardeners who work out in it? Hi, I'm Chris Cooper, and today on The Family Plot, we're talking about the brutal heat of summer and how to deal with it.
This is a production of WKNO Memphis. Production funding for The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South, is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center, in Germantown since 1943, and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center. The WKNO Production Fund. The WKNO Endowment Fund. And by viewers like you. Thank you.
Hi, welcome to The Family Plot. I'm Chris Cooper. Joining me today is Jeannie Ashworth, who is president of the Memphis Area Master Gardeners. We have UT Extension agent Mike Dennison is back with us today. And Master Gardener Tom Mashur, who's our vegetable guy. How's everybody doing today?
Doing fine.
Today we're talking about heat. This is summer in the Mid-South. As they say, the heat is on. So y'all ready for it?
No.
Okay.
Don't like it.
Well, look, Mr. Tom, we're going to jump right into it. Mm-hmm. Now, do plants have temperature ranges where they grow and produce best?
Yeah. Your summer crops can handle it on a warmer side. Your cool season crops, of course, like broccoli, cabbage, and so forth, we're past that season. But it's also time to start growing your seedlings for the fall crop. But as to what range, you know, like tomatoes, peppers, squash, cucumbers, anything members of the cucurbits family,
okay,
or the nightshade family, which includes tomatoes, peppers, potatoes, eggplant, I guess tomatillos, can handle a little bit higher heat. But as far as specific ranges for each particular vegetable, there, as far as I know, there is no particular listing on anything like that.
Okay.
Mike might have something to add to that.
The thing I want to let folks know is plants don't have the same feelings as people. Sometimes we talk to them and all that, but plants don't have the same feelings as people. And that the high temperatures, in a lot of cases, is what they're used to, especially the native plants, is what they're adapted to. And they do well with the temperatures that we've been having lately. All you have to do is look at the farmers' crops out there. They're blowing and going. If you have adequate moisture, the plants do well with temperatures in the 80s and 90s. Mm-hmm. If you get up over that, up into the upper 90s, up around 100 degrees, and then it can interfere with pollination. The plants begin to wilt, and they are stressed. But plants that are adapted to this area can handle high heat and high humidity.
Yeah.
The people out there working with them now.
That's going to be a different story, right?
They can do quite as well.
The plants can actually prefer high humidity, where we kind of prefer low humidity.
Okay. Makes sense. Now, like, what are some of the effects of the hot soil and the hot air on, like, vegetable gardens, though?
Well, you're going to need more water to keep it moist. And, of course, some type of covering on the soil to keep the sun directly off the soil, mm-hmm, as a mulch. In my case, all my grass clippings go right into the garden, and I use it as a mulch, and in the fall I till them in. But it also has the effect of, besides keeping the sun off, it helps keep the soil cooler, mm-hmm, and it also has a tendency to deter weeds. Not perfectly, but it does lessen them quite a bit, especially young weeds, weeds coming up, it has a tendency to kill it.
Okay. And I guess that answers some of the questions about compensating, mm-hmm, for the hot heat on your vegetable gardens, mulching, which you already talked about. Mm-hmm. Now, as far as watering, what do you use out in your vegetable garden to do that? And what is the best way to water your vegetable garden?
Whatever best way is whatever convenient for you.
Okay, sure.
Now, to me, it depends a little bit on your soil conditions. Like, I use a drip system, and a drip system is pretty good, especially when I'm out of town like I was last week. The wife just goes on and turns the faucet on. It's ready to go. Okay. The problem with a drip system is if you have a sandy soil, the water has a tendency to go straight down. Hmm. It doesn't spread out. Whereas with a hose and a watering nozzle, you can get there in do a bit better coverage. So I have to augment my drip line with some actually hand watering. The biggest problem, of course, is dragging a hose through the garden.
Sure.
They don't like it, and it's always a pain. It always catches on something. You have to go back and then, or put a kink in the hose. You have to go back and do it.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this. Is there a better time of day to water?
Absolutely. Early in the morning is usually the best time. And I've mentioned in the past, you usually don't like to water at night, and I use the expression, you don't want to go to bed with your feet wet, neither do the plants. But if you come home from work or whatever you've been doing and the plant's showing stress, don't wait. You know, give it the water right then and there.
Okay. And the same thing applies to your lawns. You know, it's best to water your lawns first thing in the morning. Mm-hmm. You lose a lot of evaporation, water to evaporation, you know, if you're watering throughout the day. You know, so it's best to do it first thing in the morning.
Sprinkler system.
Yes.
But the drip system, you don't lose as much to evaporation. Mm-hmm. But if you do come in after work and something needs to be watered, try not to get the foliage wet. Mm-hmm. You know, try to just water down under the base of the plant, because fungal diseases this time of the year, with the warm conditions, they really like those leaves wet going into the night.
And that's the advantage of a drip system. You're under the foliage, and also even on the drip system, you cover it up with leaf grass clippings and stuff like that. But and ideally, a lot of times when people will water, they'll water just right around the roots, what they think is root system. In reality, you want to water in at least a 2-foot radius. You want to encourage the roots to spread out looking for water, and therefore you got more roots supporting the additional growth that's going to happen throughout the growing season.
And I'll tell you what I see a lot too. You know, I'm a pretty avid runner, so I'm running through neighborhoods, and you know, people on their cell phones, they have the hose with the sprinkler head, and they're out there talking on the phone just watering in one spot, their lawn. Mm-hmm. I mean, you're doing more harm to the lawn than you are good, okay? Because you're not developing that root system when you're just watering like that. Mm-hmm. I mean, if you're going to water your lawn, you need to water deeply but infrequently. And you want to water to at least a depth of about 4 to 6 inches, you know, and that way you will build that root system up. But I see that a lot, you know, people just kind of out there, just water here, water there, and it's just doing more harm than good.
Actually, that's where you always have these peanut jars left over, what to do with them. If you set them up, maybe put a rock or something like that around the lawn with your sprinkler system. If you want like an inch of rain or inch of water, just set them around the lawn until you get all of them at least an inch deep. And you know you got adequate watering.
Okay, that's a good way.
Probably worth repeating though, water deeply. Do a good job of watering rather than frequently. About an inch a week is enough.
Right.
And you can split that into one or two applications, but no more than twice a week if you do a good job of watering.
That is exactly right. Now, should you fertilize in hot weather?
Yeah.
What are your thoughts about that?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I get hungry in the heat. I get hungry in the cold. So, yeah, the inner plants do, but just don't overdo it. One of those little soil testers I use, it's got a little two probes. You plug it in there, and it tells you your pH, and it tells you your fertilizer level. Just get one of those. They're very expensive, less around $20. And you just go around periodically, and you just actually test it to find out if it's got a little meter on it, tells you if it's below adequate or too much.
Okay.
If you'll keep it in the mid-range, then it's fine.
I think using a soil moisture meter could probably do the same thing for you also.
Well, especially the plants that aren't leguminous plants, like tomatoes and corn and things like that. You keep in mind that unless you're using a slow-release form of nitrogen, that nitrogen that you put out there before planting or at planting only lasts about 4 to 6 weeks. So those plants, your tomatoes, your peppers, your corn, needs to be side-dressed with a nitrogen fertilizer. Unless, of course, you did use a slow-release form of nitrogen. The leguminous plants like beans, peas, and things like that, that's probably not necessary to do any fertilizing to those types of plants.
Okay. I know for your lawn and for some of your flowering plants, potassium is really important, you know, second right behind nitrogen, because if you have sufficient levels of potassium in your soil, it actually builds up resistance to drought.
Right.
I know that.
But you also need to keep in mind that potassium is the most stable of the fertilizer elements. And if you follow the soil test recommendations and you put out the amount of potassium last fall or this spring that the soil test recommended, that potassium will be okay for the whole year. phosphate for or potash is a little bit less. You know, it doesn't last as long in the environment, but it will still get you through the season.
Okay.
Nitrogen is what you need to be side dressing with or top dressing with these crops.
Leaches out pretty quick.
That's right.
Well, in its natural state, nitrogen is a gas. So eventually it's going to escape out of the soil. I mean, the largest source of nitrogen in the world is the atmosphere.
Mm-hmm.
It's, what, 88% nitrogen. So the nitrogen is going to turn back to a gas, escape out of the soil, so you just got to replace that.
Okay, well, sounds good. Well, let's move on to our personal safety issue in hot weather. Mm-hmm. As much as we want to keep our lawns and gardens healthy during hot weather, we have to pay attention to personal safety as well. Mm-hmm. Now, Ms. Jeannie, it's hot, high humidity. How do we stay hydrated in this heat?
Tom has already brought up the issue that plants are kind of like people, even though they don't have sensitivities like people.
Same
feelings. Plants wilt, people wilt. And I think we hear all sorts of terminology, hypothermia, heat exhaustion, heat stroke. The easiest thing for people to remember is it's a dehydration. Mm. In other words, we've lost more fluid than our body can afford to lose. We need fluid for circulation. Fluid is in every cell in our body. It's in our joints. So consequently, as we perspire, mm-hmm. we lose fluid. Now, there are lots of people that can't perspire or don't perspire adequately. Those are folks that are on all types of medications. Those with hypertension, those that have heart problems, those that have seizures, those that have asthma. The list goes on and on and on. Even healthy people perspire and then run out of perspiration. And those are your degrees of dehydration. When you are thirsty, your body is about 2% down. You've sweated off or urinated off at least 2% of your body fluid. Mm. And at 5%, you're going to start having some symptoms. Those would be what we call heat exhaustion. Mm-hmm. You would have dull headache. You might feel a little bit of muscle weakness. Right. Keep in mind, you're losing your fluid. Your urine, you may not be going to the bathroom, or it's very, very dark color.
Okay.
Yes, folks, you should be looking at what you're doing if you're doing this type of thing.
Sure.
As this progresses to 5 to 10%, you are now in the heat stroke range, and this is critical to life. In other words, if you've lost 5 to 10% of your fluid volume, you no longer have the perspiration to sweat. You are now red. Your skin is dry. Mm. You are confused if you're awake. This is delirium. This is a medical emergency that requires 911. So how do we prevent that? When you get thirsty, keep in mind you've lost at least 2% of your fluid volume. You drink, but what do you drink? You don't drink a beer because it's summertime. You don't go drink that Southern Sweet iced tea. Yeah. That's a caffeine product. So alcohol is out, any of your alcoholic beverages. And for heaven's sakes, the alcohol caffeine beverages, the new boosts that are out there, avoid those. Caffeine is a diuretic, which will make you urinate more. So consequently, you're accelerating that. Believe it or not, salty and sugary drinks are no-nos also because they throw off or require even more fluid being drawn out of your body for your body to handle that extra boost of sugar or salt. So plain old water is the best thing in the water. If you don't like the taste of it, put a little bit of lemon in it or put a little bit of mint if you've got it out in your yard and keep yourself hydrated. I think that's the most important thing.
This is some good information. Let me ask you about this. Beer after you finish, right?
No. You go in and you take your bath and you rest. And a light meal, not a heavy meal.
Right.
In fact, that's how you get your salts replaced in your body and your sugars, is through a very light meal, not going in and consuming salt tablets. Don't go and try to cure yourself by buying salt tablets because you're going out in the yard to sweat. No. That throws your electrolytes off even more. You want to try to maintain that hydration and then rest frequently and change the tasks that you're doing.
Right.
Limit your work to 7 or 8 o'clock in the morning till 10 a.m. Don't work between 12 and 4 o'clock. Remember, lots of these countries in the tropical area take siestas? Well, we need to learn to do that. And important, we need to remember our pets, too. They don't handle this heat any better than we do. So fresh water for them, a shady spot to rest in.
And no beer.
And no beer.
No beer.
Even for those slugs.
No beer for the pets.
Right.
But let me ask you this, though. I usually drink like Gatorade or something like that right after I, you know, finish mowing the lawn.
I'd suggest that you go with the water first,
okay?
And if you are one of these people that has the dull headache, you're nauseated, you're really feeling weak, this is the time to chew on some ice or sip some cool water. Don't guzzle it down, and be aware of overhydrating with fluids that have salts and sugars in them at that time. Yes, you can supplement it after you've come in and cooled off.
Right. Okay.
And anyone that you find, there's an old wives' statement or grandma's statement, if your face is pale, you raise your tail. So in other words, if you are clammy, you've been outside and you've perspired to profusion, then the best thing in the world to do is to drink a little bit of water, recline, and rest in the shade. If your face is red, you raise your head. And these are the folks that are dry, they're delirious, they require a 911 call. You want to cool their body temperature down, you want to stay with them, you want to keep them up, and do not give them anything to drink.
Wow, wonderful information. Let me ask you about this too. Definitely need to get this out. What do you need to wear to protect yourself from the sun?
Oh, best things in the world are light clothing, light colored, lightweight, as well as something covering your head, whether it be a hat, a cap, old-fashioned do-rags are wonderful. You get them wet and you just plop it on your head. Also, you want to make sure that, as I said, you change your tasks that you're doing. In other words, don't get out there and do all of one thing continually. For the 2 hours that you're out there, you're going to stop every 15, 20 minutes, have a swig or two on your bottle of water, and then there you go.
Okay. Let's get this last question into it. What about if you're on medication?
Okay, if you are on medications, first of all, it's important that you carry your cell phone out in the yard with you. And you also, if you are on diuretics, you're on anti-seizure medication, you're a diabetic, you're on drugs that have blood thinners in them for irregular heartbeats or other problems that you've had like strokes, you need to have that medical alert. And you also need to have your neighbors and friends aware that you are out there. And again, limit the hours that you're out there. You do not want to be out there from 12 o'clock to 4 o'clock in the afternoon.
Wow. Okay, that was some excellent information. Remember, we'd like to hear from you. Here's how to send an email, a letter, or maybe a photo or two for future shows.
Send us an email with your questions and a photo or two. The address is familyplot@wkno.org. Or if you'd rather send a letter, the mailing address is WKNO Attention Family Plot, 7151 Cherry Farms Road, Cordova, Tennessee. The zip is 38016. We're looking forward to hearing from you.
2%. Yeah.
Now we're down 2%. To the viewer email portion of the show. Miss Ann writes, I have recently gathered some bulbils from a common orange tiger lily and wonder how best to plant them. Do I do that now or in the fall? How deep and in what sort of soil? Garden or pot? What sort of exposure, etc.? Also wonder how long they will have to grow before they can bloom. Any help you can give would be greatly appreciated. Miss Ann, I actually have some of these in my landscape at home. Those bulbils, get you a pot, fill that pot up with some potting soil, gently press those bulbils on the surface. You can actually cover it up with about a half an inch of that potting soil, or I learned this from Miss Susie, sand. Okay? You can do this now, late summer. It would be a really good time to do it, be late summer. Put that pot outside in a protected area. Now, in order to get flowers that bloom, you're going to have to be patient. It's going to take 3 or 4 years. Mm-hmm. 3 to 4 years. Then you can go ahead and find you a nice little spot out in your garden. Well-drained soil, so mix that soil with some compost. Full sun. We'll deal with a little partial shade, but likes full sun better. And then the birds, the hummingbirds, butterflies are going to love it. So that's how you do that. And they're going to be beautiful plants. I mean, they bloom pretty much mid, late summer.
And they handle our heat.
And they handle the heat. Mm-hmm. Yeah. And that can actually handle some poor soils. I mean, you want a well-drained soil, but it can handle poor soils.
Well, that brings up the thing that I like to start everything from seeds.
Okay.
My perennials, whatever. And a couple of times I made some boo-boos in that I planted and got my perennials up and they didn't bloom. So I said, well, what the heck? You know, why waste my time? Not knowing that most perennials do not bloom the first year.
Not the first year.
So you have to wait for the second, third,
fourth. You have to wait. And this is a perennial. You're going to have to wait, like I said, 3 to 4 years. Usually, they're going to put on roots pretty quick. They're going to go dormant in the wintertime. And then that first spring, you're going to see a leaf. And most people will keep it in the pot for at least 2 years. And then they'll transplant it, put it out in the garden. And those bulbils you actually find in the leaf axle of the tiger lily itself. Yeah. All right, so there you go, Miss Ann. Here's our next question from Miss Hazel. She says, I am trying to raise tomatoes and peppers in pots. They have lots of blooms, but none ever set. What is my soil lacking? I keep them moist if it doesn't rain. They're in Miracle-Gro that is supposed to hold water. They get ample sunshine. One plant has 2 tomatoes and lots of blooms, but they just fall off. The peppers do the same thing. I watched your show and thought maybe you can help me. Thank you. Well, thank you, Ms. Hazel, for watching. And I think we actually just talked about this a little earlier. It has to do with the heat, Mr. Tom.
Yeah, like I said, in the when we start having those high evening temperatures at night, when it starts getting 80 degrees at the coolest point, tomatoes just don't like to set. Mm-hmm. But then if you be patient, keep watering it, as soon as our nighttime start dropping, temperatures start dropping a little bit, they'll start probably setting tomatoes for you. And one thing I always wonder, why do they make these big pots black? You know, why not
absorb
white?
All the heat, huh?
Yeah, I mean, they're getting hotter. And, of course, you got to keep it moist,
sure.
Adequately moist. And, again, it's a good idea to check the fertilizer. But if it's Miracle-Gro, as far as I know, it's supposed to come with fertilizer in it. Supposed to last 3 months or something of that nature. So just hang tough.
Hang tough. Yeah, if the nighttime temperatures for tomatoes are above, like, 72, then those blooms are going to fall off. And it's actually the same thing for peppers.
Mm-hmm. Well, they're the same family, too.
Yeah, well, same family, right.
Yeah.
So. Patience.
Patience.
Okay, here's our next question. I had carpenter bees boring in my deck last year, and now they're back again. Mr. D, how do I get rid of them?
Well, there are a couple of insecticides that you can use. The wasp and hornet killers that come in, you know, the aerosol cans will do a pretty good job. If you can get to the holes that were bored in there late in the day, if you could... put some dust, insecticidal dust, like Carbaryl or something like that, and kind of inject that into the holes. The bees are in there, and when they come out, they'll get the dust on them, and it'll kill them. If you can do that, that will work. It's also a good idea to use wood putty to, you know, fill the holes in, and you can kind of paint over them. But you can use wire. Stick a wire in there and kill them. You know, they don't, they bore straight into the wood. But if you can find an insecticide that has a residual, you can spray that, put it in like a garden sprayer and spray the wood. There aren't many left out there on the market that we can still use. If you happen to have some old Dursban left over, a chlorpyrifos, that was a good material to use, but you can't buy that anymore.
Right.
You can use, if you have it, you can use it. Also, painting and shellacking and you know, putting those kind of things on wood kind of helps repel carpenter bees also.
Okay. Well, let me ask you this. What time of the day is best to do this? When are carpenter bees active?
They're active during the daytime. During the daytime. So if you're wanting to kill them with contact killers like the Raid and Black Flag and Hot Shot and those aerosol can wasp and bee killers, then you do that during the daytime. If you're wanting to use the dust, it's best to do that late in the day, at night even, when they're in there. They're not active. They're in the hole, and you kind of inject that dust in there, and that'll do the trick for you.
Okay, well, we're down to our last question. It says, I watched the show, which was about the Master Gardener program. I live in Tipton County. Do they have a Master Gardener program there? Yes, they do. Yes. They do. And good Mr. one. Booker T. Lee yes. is the coordinator of the Master Gardener Program in Tipton County. It is a good one. Mm-hmm. It is. Call the Extension office there in Tipton County. Ask to talk to Mr. Booker T. Lee. And they are accepting applications now for their Master Gardener Program. Yeah. And if you live in Fayette County, Ms. Tanya Ashworth, who was on the show before, is the coordinator of the Master Gardener Program there. And they are also accepting applications for their program.
As we are in Memphis.
As we are. Right. Just call the Extension office. Let me know that you're interested. We have applications already online. You can come by the office and pick those up. And that'll be it. Mm-hmm. That's all the time we have for today. Be sure to join us next week. And remember, you can send us an email or a letter with your gardening questions and photos. I'm Chris Cooper, and I'll see you next time on The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South. Be safe out there now.
Production funding for The Family Plot, Gardening in the Mid-South is provided by Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center in Germantown since 1943 and continuing to offer its plants for successful gardening with 7 greenhouses and 3 acres of plants, plus comprehensive landscape services. Goodwin's Landscape and Garden Center,